Hi there, everyone. Once again, we're at the Royal Society with a very, very complicated, giant, golden instrument. Even Keith called this fiendishly complicated.
The maker called it fiendishly complicated. That's going some.
Okay, then. It's very impressive. What is this?
This is a repeating azimuth, and it was constructed by a guy called Edward Troughton, very famous instrument maker. He went through several company incarnations. The last one was called Troughton and Simms, but he was a fellow of the Royal Society, so quite a senior figure, and he made astronomical instruments for surveying.
As I understand it, we have two sort of telescopes here,
yep,
either side of this big circular disc, and they do move independently of each other.
Yeah.
As I understand it, you'll look through one and you'll look through the other at two points and
That's
make
right.
a measurement, and then you kind of move these telescopes into different positions and look at the same object and then take measurements off the circle of the angles. And you're basically reducing errors until you're getting more and more accurate measurements?
That's right. So you're repeating observations of one fixed point and the point to which you want to measure the angle. So you're looking at how high is a particular mountain, for instance.
It looks like it's seen some action. Was this used for surveying? Would this have been given to surveyors and scientists and sent out into the field so they could measure mountains? Or?
That's right. It's associated with Captain Henry Cator, whom we've met before in Objectivity. He was involved as a young officer in the Great Trigonometrical Survey of India.
This led to them figuring out that Mount Everest was the highest mountain in the world, ultimately.
Eventually, yes. And Edward Troughton provided instruments for Cator. When Cator came back to London, he became fascinated by the business of making more and more accurate instruments. So this would have been on the Indian survey, this instrument.
So this was shipped over to India, carted all around the continent to take measurements, and then brought back here.
That's right, yeah. Most of the Royal Society's instruments, you know, they're kind of revered museum objects these days, but they've had hard working lives, most of them, and they were loaned out and used by scientists.
Like you, Keith, revered, but you've had a hard working life.
Yeah, that's exactly right. I feel like I should be in a case like this.
Now, one thing that's really interesting and noticeable, obviously, is how fine and detailed all the markings are, and obviously that's really, really important, that the markings on the instrument itself are incredibly accurate.
That's right.
And that leads to something else you've got sitting over in the corner that's worth a look.
Yeah, Edward Troughton produced a manuscript on how to make instruments that accurate and what he did along the way. So we should maybe have a look at that.
So here's Troughton's paper that Keith was referring to. We can see his name on it here. Many, many Royal Society papers have what I would consider to be overly lengthy titles.
Precision titles, Brady, precision.
This one takes the cake. And Keith, I will let you do the honours of reading the title of this paper while I go and make a cup of tea.
An account of the method of dividing astronomical and other instruments by ocular inspection, in which the usual tools for graduating are not employed. The whole operation being so contrived that no error can occur but what is chargeable to vision when assisted by the best optical means of viewing and measuring minute quantities by Mr. Edward Troughton.
You couldn't even fit that title into one of these new 280 character tweets. That's massive.
You couldn't really, could you? But look here, I mean, this is kind of important. So if you can see, it's communicated by the Astronomer Royal. Now, Troughton is making instruments for the Royal Observatory Greenwich. That's how good he is.
And Keith, you kind of feel a bit like this paper is him giving away his trade secrets.
Well, that's right. He made his living by being an instrument maker, and here he's telling everybody how to do it. It was good professional practice, and what he's trying to do is to make a reputation amongst the men who are going to be using his instruments as scientists.
All right, well, if you want to find out the secrets of the trade, we're not going to read all these pages and pages to you. You'll have to come to the Royal Society yourself and plough through these documents.
Gosh,
it's a long paper. Look at this. As the paper continues, here at the end of the paper, we even have all the tables of things he's done to show apparent errors and correct errors.
So he's making the case for the absolute accuracy of these instruments.
And then we have some nice graphs there at the end. And we see some numbers and gradings there. Another plate here as well. This one catches my eye. He was obviously using some kind of lamp or light to calibrate his telescope. Very interesting.
And of course, he describes the instrument itself that we've just seen in print. So this is the Philosophical Magazine. This is 1822. And he's writing about exactly that kind of instrument and the principles behind it. So you can see here an account of the repeating circle and of the altitude and azimuth instrument, describing their different constructions.
the manner of performing their principal adjustments, and how to make observations with them, together with a comparison of their respective advantages.
That is another terribly, terribly long title for a paper. But and then again, he describes here in this paper how to work the instrument, and
we should really have read this before we started playing with the instrument, shouldn't we?
Well, I'm even more embarrassed to say I did read it, and I still don't know how the instrument works. So it's good to see these amazing instruments, but it's also really interesting to see all these papers and documents that go into how it was made. So next time I'm here, Keith, I expect you to give me a full briefing, a full lesson on how to use that thing.
Yep, coming right up.
He's literally painting a picture with 1,000 words.
He is, yes, yeah.
So he goes into like incredible detail of every image that can be found all the way along this mosaic pavement. Gosh, it goes on a bit.
This is a big pavement, Brady. It's a good pavement to pick, I have to say. This is a good choice. I'm getting quite excited now.
We've got bits of, looks like we've got some Greek writing now.
Yeah.
Wow.